the opening scenes of the TV series Roots. Omaro, the father of Punta Kinte, lifts the newborn child toward a star-spangled sky and says, "Behold, the only thing greater than yourself." And now we are the first people in all of history to know how truly immense that which is greater than ourselves really is. It is not just the amazing canopy of the stars overhead, the visible vault of heaven that the ancients knew so well. Their numbering system only went to 99,999. After all, they did not need more than that to count sheep and count. They could not have imagined that they were looking at not only billions of stars, but billions of galaxies, each with its own billions of stars. And most of those galaxies are many, many light years away. Now we hear the phrase light years, and we fail to realize we are talking about numbers in the trillions. Did you know that if you tried to count to a trillion and were able to say one number each second, which you cannot do because when you get to a certain point, they're too long to say in a second. But if you could say it that way, you would get to 1 trillion in 31,688 years. That's 1 trillion. Our nearest neighboring star is 4.3 light years away, or 25.283 trillion miles. How could the ancients ever have imagined such distances? The only thing greater than ourselves. If I were designing a cathedral today, at least a couple of the windows would be pictures from the Hubble telescope. And we are part of the big it, what my sister calls the great big wow. We are made of the same stuff as the stars. The percentage of salt in human blood is the same as the percentage of salt in seawater at the time the earliest life on Earth was developing. 99% of the mass of the human body is made up of just six elements: oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, calcium, and phosphorus. Star stuff. We know more today about nature and the universe than any previous generation has ever known, and our knowledge is growing exponentially. Exotic devices found only in Star Trek when I was a kid are now commonplace. Cell phones, the communicators, iPods, tablets, and soon to follow, maybe replicators, and perhaps even the beam me up Scotty machine. When they do that, I've got a place or two I'd like to be. 90% of all scientists who have ever lived are alive today. And according to Google's CEO, Eric Schmidt, every 2 days we now create as much information as was created between the dawn of civilization and 2003. Think about that when you're feeling a little overwhelmed, too much information. I wonder if that is why we also seem more detached from nature than at any other time in history. We tend to make our lives and even our worship predictable and manageable, and as a result, sometimes we have a hard time connecting to this overwhelming reality. But we are connected. We are profoundly connected, and we need to regain that connection. A professor of mine once told a classroom full of ministerial students who seemed to think they had it all figured out, "If you think you have God in your black box, what you've got is an empty black box." In seminary, we studied many images of God, many descriptions of God, but the one that spoke to me was the one that I found in a textbook about faith-based psychotherapy, of all things. In a book titled The Art of the Psychotherapist, Blumenthal speaks of the wild God, They have said that God is dead, and it may be so. But I believe that the God who is dead is the God of the cage, the zoo God. We thought to contain the zoo God by our definitions, our interpretations, our inventions. That God whom we captured and domesticated is in our intellectual zoo of exotic concepts. That God has not thrived in captivity, and that God has died. But the wild God, the God that cannot be captured by our wills or our intellects, the wild God who will not be domesticated, is alive and as free as ever. He moves in the wind. She sings in the silences of the desert. It nourishes us in the sun. The wild God is more than the God of evolution. The wild God breathes revolution as well. The zoo God could not take us by surprise. We visited him at our convenience and chiefly as children. The zoo God could not upset the comfortable routines of our lives, and he seemed, until he died, to require little feeding with anything that mattered. Not to be so trained as the wild God, who may overturn everything as he comes into our lives. She may demand all we have as it devours our complacency and requires us to change totally, fragmentally. Tell it called the wild God, the God above God. The wild God is the God of mystery. We deny mystery, we pretend it exists only in the minds of children, authors, and mystics. And we deceive and blind ourselves when we do so. The wild God comes upon us in ways we cannot predict and in forms we do not expect. The wild God shakes the ground under our feet, obscures the path we follow, and makes us where we dwell in cages that we have constructed and that we call reality. Mystery involves knowledge, contains knowledge. Mystery is infinite, knowledge is finite. As knowledge grows, even more does mystery grow. Mystery is the latent meaning always awaiting our discovery. Those who recognize and respect the omnipresence of mystery need not take refuge in fatalism or that form of mysticism which is wispy and precious. The openness of possibility is also a powerful encouragement to reconceive the familiar, to attempt anew, and to explore with innocence of perception. If we seek the wild God, we must go out into the world, into the dangers and opportunities, sometimes go without a map and without a compass and without enough food, without protection or anything. And as we seek the wild God, we may be captured by God. For mystery comprehends us. We do not comprehend it. The God of the universe is unimaginable. Literally, we cannot imagine what is to know of God. And yet, the astounding assertion of faith then and now is that we know. That each of us is known and treasured by the same God, the wild God of all that immensity, the God that is the first dimension of all that is the first dimension of us. And part of our job as living beings is to simply appreciate and care for creation. Our wow is an important form of praise. You see, awe doesn't appear to have any non-biological function. Awe is part of the amazing connection between us and the transcendent. This connection is wholly beyond. Annie Dillon calls it wholly the firm. It is unique for each of us, but embracing us all. Moses knew a wide variety of religions. He knew the Hebrew religion from his mother and sister, who saved him from Pharaoh into the house of Pharaoh's daughter. He knew all the gods of Egypt and the gods of Midian. At the time of the encounter on the mountain, he was herding his father-in-law's sheep in the land of Midian. And this man who knew so many gods consumed, and like any god, he knew. And the voice of God spoke, "Moses, Moses, here I am. Take off your shoes. You are on holy ground." One of the religious debates of those days was whether that holy ground was the mountain or the holy ground was in Jerusalem in the temple. But for me, the truly holy ground was the spiritual connection between Moses and the transcendent God. God reached out to Moses with a symbol, a burning bush, entirely different from any of the gods he had known. And much more important than the burning bush itself was the living connection, an interactive connection, a unique connection. And this is holy ground for each of us. How different each of us is, and how different are our needs. In seminary, we were working on our own, what is our own most important personal image of God. And for me, I was sharing in class, and I said, for me, it's the God of, I think of it as the God of the lab. And it's just that I can climb up in God's lap and be held and loved and cared for when life is just completely overwhelming, or I'm too sad or too hurt. And in the back of the class the whole time, there was this guy going, "It's this way." And the professor said, and would let me go on. And I said, it's not hard to imagine how that happened, because in my human life, my younger sister was born very soon after I was, and I lost my earthly lap pretty early. So that affects how we perceive, how we meet God, and therefore perceive. But in the back, this guy is still going. He's just gone crazy. He's almost jumping up and sitting. Finally, the professor calls him. He says, "No, no, that just drives me crazy. My mother was a smother mother." I was a different mama to each of my four children. I was not always the mama they needed, but I loved and love each of them in their own way. And each of those relationships is unique. God is always willing to be the heavenly parent who comes to meet us in our individual needs. And when we leave the light of God, like the father of the prodigal son, part of God's heart goes with us. A unique connection to God that is ours and ours alone. The connection between us then, as we stand before God, is also holy ground. We must tread lightly in our community, careful of the holy ground of each of us and the holy ground between us. We too must take off our shoes, for it is indeed holy ground. Jesus was in the habit of going out onto the hills around the towns where he spent the night before dawn, where he went to pray. When he looked up, guess what he saw? That amazing night sky full of stars. No light pollution, no nothing that would obscure that view at all. And below, the village, the hamlet, the city full of people. Beneath that sky, looking out at the earth and her people, he prayed and he listened and he connected with a God so much bigger than the gods and idols of the religions that surrounded him, and even the limited view of the true God of the Hebrews. He lifted his face to the night sky, to the God above all gods, and realized, you love them all, don't you? You do. It is you I trust. Out beyond our laws and our governments and our own thinking, bigger than anything we can imagine, God, I trust you. And he often called the God of all that immensity, Abba. It doesn't translate as father, it translates as daddy or papa. Imagine our Abba, our papa in heaven. Jesus became the light of the world with this understanding, this revelation, and calls us to be be light also. Holy ground, the kingdom of God is within you and all around you. There is much to do, and we are much challenged to do it. But first, in the presence of God, on your holy ground, be held, be accepted, be valued, be cherished, be affirmed, be loved.